right, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, sentient creations of all shapes, colors, and sizes, welcome back to another exciting episode of the Live Free FM radio show. I'm your host, Nathan Fraser, and today we've got a very, very special guest, somebody that I'm super excited to have on the air, somebody who's, in my opinion, one of the liberties, or one of the rock stars of the liberty media movement, and that is Jeff Berwick. Jeff is very active. He's involved with the Dollar Vigilante. I think maybe he might be one of the like founders of it, actually. And also with a very awesome YouTube, probably my favorite YouTube channel, which is the Anarchast channel. Jeff, I kind of gave a brief introduction to let people know what you're involved with, but what are some of the other things that you're involved with?
Well, first of all, thank you, Nathan, for having me on. It's a pleasure. Those are the two big media things I'm doing at the moment. I've been doing the Dollar Vigilante since about 2010, and I've been doing Anarchast since about 2011, I believe. I think it's been about 3 years now. We've interviewed about 170 anarchists to date. And so those are the two main ways that people know me. I also am in the media quite a bit. I've been on CNBC, Fox, Bloomberg, trying to explain to old people what Bitcoin is. And I've also been on many different conferences, and I'm actually throwing my own conference down here in Acapulco, Mexico at the end of February called Anarchapulco. So yeah, you're quite correct when you say I'm quite busy.
Yeah, and definitely I want to get into Anarchapulco. I want to get into Bitcoin. I want to get into a lot of stuff today. But before we jump into that, I like to have every guest, when I have them on, I like to have them share a liberty quote that resonates with them, who it's by, and why it resonates with them. And I believe that you had one available, didn't you?
Yeah, we were talking about Henry David Thoreau, and of course he was the 1800s, a very early anarchist, which is amazing, because back then there wasn't too much big federal government around. And so even back then, in like the early and mid 1800s, he already had recognized how evil government was. And he had a quote that said, "Disobedience is the true foundation of liberty. The obedient must be slaves." And I picked that quote. I actually asked a bunch of my Facebook friends and fans what their favorite liberty quotes were. And that one really, I like that one the most at the moment. Of course, I change all the time, but at that time, I liked it, and I liked it because it's very succinct, and it also really exemplifies what it is about freedom. And if you really believe that you don't want to have someone rule you without your consent, so you don't want to obey people who just say that they rule you, then you are an anarchist. You are a libertarian. You're a freedom fighter. And Henry David Thoreau really put it well by saying, "Disobedience is the true foundation of liberty." And some people can misconstrue that quote and think that it means that you should be a rebel. That's not necessarily the case at all. All it's saying is that if you that the true foundation of liberty is disobedience of people who are trying to rule you without your consent. Now, if you want to enter into contractual obligations with people and you say this person can do this or that person can do that, that's fine. But the fact that people are so willing to let people rule them for no reason whatsoever is highly excellent example of the world we live in today, with so many slaves out there who are just totally comfortable with people ruling over them for no real reason whatsoever, and telling them what to do and taking their money. And so it's, I think that quote is more appropriate now than it even ever was.
Yeah, and it's crazy because you mentioned that was, oh gosh, 150 years ago that quote was written. And back then there were a very, very few amount of thinkers. Lysander Spooner comes to mind. Thoreau comes to mind. But a lot of people had this sentiment that the government of Britain was bad, but the government of America was a necessary evil. And Thoreau was one of the people that was back there saying, look, it's just evil. It's not a necessary evil. It's just evil. And that seems to be it seems to be a thought that's actually catching on now. But back then, definitely, it was one out of a couple of million people who would, or even a couple billion people that would think that way. And now it seems to be I would say that a lot of what people like you are doing is definitely leading to this thought catching fire. But it seems to be like this thought is becoming more and more prevalent in society, even starting to gain mainstream acceptance.
Yeah, as I was pointing out, it was quite amazing that people like Henry David Thoreau and Lysander Spooner all recognized this back in the days when really government was nowhere near as atrocious as it is today, nowhere near as oppressive. The federal government didn't even have income taxes back then, and they had already recognized that it was evil to have a government that you don't consent to. And of course, the social contract is not consent. It's not a contract if you didn't sign it and if you didn't agree to it. So it's really quite amazing that they were so ahead of their time, really, to catch on. And the real reason that this message is completely catching on right now, I've talked about this for years, and I've seen the growth. It's been unbelievable to see the growth over the last few years, is because governments are becoming more and more tyrannical and oppressive every day. We're seeing that, of course, with what's going on in Ferguson and all throughout the U.S., and people are starting to realize that having centrally planned, essentially communist-style policing and centrally planned anything is a disaster. Human history has been riddled with nothing but disasters whenever you have governments, and that includes Rome, and that includes every single government in the history of this earth. There's never been a good one, and it's not possible. It's not possible to be a good one. That's why they say it's a necessary evil, because it is evil. But it isn't necessary. It's unnecessary. And now, thanks to the internet, we actually have the ability to exchange information and to really look into what has been going on throughout human history. And we actually have access to that information for the first time, because before, most people, all they really knew is what they were taught by the government in their government indoctrination camps. And so it's an incredible time right now, thanks to the internet, that people are really waking up. And we actually saw that this week with Glenn Beck. I don't know if you saw this on Facebook, but Glenn Beck asked, I guess it wasn't a true poll or a true vote, but he asked his Facebook fans, which he has about 3 million of them, who they think should be Person of the Year. And a few anarchists posted Larkin Rose, and then I posted Larkin Rose, who's a great anarchist thinker. And all of a sudden, almost every anarchist on the internet somehow found out about it, and they started bombing the Facebook page, and there was literally thousands of them. And every single answer was Larkin Rose, Larkin Rose, Larkin Rose. And it really, you wouldn't have seen that a couple of years ago. This is just all blooming right now, thanks to the internet. People are getting access to this information. And once people realize what we know, they get really, first of all, they get really scared, usually, because their whole worldview changes like in a second. They're like, what? Everything that I thought probably wasn't correct and probably was the opposite of correct. But then once they start to realize and they start to get more comfortable with it, they start to get really excited because they start to think, wow, we could have an amazing world if more people knew this sort of information.
So you mentioned kind of how that paradigm shift affects a lot of people. I know that most of my listeners can probably relate with that, but what was it for you? How was your journey to these ideas? How was your paradigm shift? What was it that took you from where you were initially, and where were you initially, and then what was it that kind of pushed you towards these ideas?
Well, as I look back on my life, I realize I've always been an anarchist at heart, but I didn't even really know what that word was, or even the word libertarian, until about 2002. Until that point, I'd been living like an anarchist. I always didn't like government. When I was younger, actually, when I was around 14, I got into government because I really wanted the world to be a better place. I saw all this poverty, I saw all these wars, I saw all these problems, and I thought, well, I have to do something. And so I tried to get into government. But within a year or two, I really realized that the government was not helping anything. It was just hurting everything. But I didn't know there was another option. And so I went on throughout my life, and I ended up starting a number of companies. I'm fairly entrepreneurial. And during that process, I began to realize just that there was other options. And the first person who really woke me up to that was Doug Casey, who's a great anarchist. He's one of the main names in the world of anarchy. And I actually had the top financial website in Canada at the time called stockhouse.com. And he came to Vancouver because we put him on our site, because as soon as I started reading his writing, I loved it. And so I had him as our top person on our site. So when he was in Vancouver, where I was at the time, time, we went out for dinner, and he started talking to me and asking me questions. And at the end of it, he said, "Well, you know what you are, don't you?" And I said, "No, what am I?" And he said, "You're a libertarian." And I had never heard that word before. And then we talked a little bit further, and he asked me more deeper questions about what I really believe and what I think is right. And he said, "Well, you know what you are, don't you?" And I said, "No." And he said, "You're an anarchist." And I went, "Anarchists, like those people who throw bombs and you know, it's chaos and riots all the time." And he said, no, that's what the media says anarchy is. But, and then he explained anarchy to me. And from that moment on, my life changed. And I went on to read every single thing I could for almost the next 10, actually to, still to this day. But I was really into it for 5 to 10 years. I just read everything I could get on anything to do with freedom, including anything to do with libertarianism, anything to do with anarchy, anything to do with Austrian economics, which is essentially anarchist economics, which is actually truthful economics. So yeah, it's been quite a wild ride. And then it was around 2007 that I was really into Austrian economics, and I was traveling the world at the time. I tried to sail around the world, and I sank my boat in El Salvador, and I just kept going, and I went to about 100 countries. And then it was about 2007, I realized that I kind of understood how the financial and monetary system worked, and I was expecting that 2008 collapse that happened. And so when that happened, I realized that I knew quite a bit of things about the economy and finance and money that most people didn't know. So I decided to start the Dollar Vigilante. I had the idea in around 2009, and it really got started in about 2010. And I've just gone on from there. And then I realized that people just don't understand what anarchy even is. So that's why I started Anarchast, and we've been interviewing anarchists ever since.
Yeah, and like I said, Anarchast is probably one of my favorite YouTube channels out there. So if anybody's not subscribed and you have a YouTube account, you should go to Anarchast and subscribe to that, because tons of great interviews with great, brilliant people and an awesome, brilliant host as well. So you mentioned that you're from Canada, and a lot of times Canada gets, at least here in America, a lot of the left Keynesian influenced economic thinkers point to Canada as this great socialist utopia and how they have free healthcare and everything's honky-dory in Canada, and people just work the limited minimal amount of time, and they get to sit around and drink beer and enjoy hockey games on their free time. And how much greater America would be if they would just adopt the socialized aspects that Canada has adopted. And you seem to not hold that same sentiment. How is it that you came from that environment and yet seem to completely reject that mentality?
Well, because I grew up there and I saw how atrocious the medical system was, that's one of the reasons. But to go back to the perception of Canada, I think that was correct probably about 20, 30 years ago, that Canada was very socialist. I still spell Canada with a K today because it was very, very socialist, very that sort of leaning, very leftist and that sort of thing. And people just love their so-called free healthcare, which isn't free, and it's not anything to do with your health, nothing good for your health. But the funny thing is that Canada has actually become more capitalist than the U.S. now. And that's why Canada's actually been doing fairly well the last 10 years, while the U.S. has been going downhill. And now, of course, the U.S. is trying to bring in Obamacare, which is a disaster already. And this is just the beginning. If you thought healthcare was bad before, just wait till it's free. They're going in different directions at the moment. So that's actually not a real thing for socialists to say anymore, how good Canada is, because they've actually turned quite a bit more capitalist. Not to say that they're capitalist at all, but they've reduced corporate taxes tremendously. They've opened up and privatized many things. They used to have the oil market used to be nationalized. They privatized that a few decades ago, and that's all improved Canada. And actually, the Canadian economy's done quite well because of all of that. But yeah, to talk to somebody about how it's a paradise. Now, it is true that people do watch hockey and drink beer a lot. That is totally true. And I still do that to this day, except for I watch it from the beach here in Acapulco over the internet, which is great, by the way. Totally high definition over the internet. So you can get that through NHL.com for anyone interested. to point it out as a socialist paradise is sort of incorrect from the American perspective now, because the U.S., which I call the USSA now, has gone almost completely socialist, and you can see all the repercussions in the U.S. And talking about to warn people to get ready for this Obamacare, it is not good at all. The Canadian medical system is so bad, it's unbelievable. I can't even... there's so many stories I can tell you of people just waiting 6 months just to see a doctor for a minor ailment. I remember when I lived there, if I ever had a fairly serious injury that I needed someone to look at right away, but it wasn't necessarily something you'd go to an emergency room for. It was just something that needed to be looked at within a day or two. It was very uncomfortable for whatever reason. And you would always just have to go to the emergency room because you'd have to wait weeks to see a doctor in your normal doctor office. And the emergency room, of course, just full of people, literally hundreds of people in Vancouver where I'm from, and you'd have to sit there for at least 12 hours before anyone even talked to you. It's atrocious. And that's another reason why I live in Mexico, because they still have an incredibly private medical system here, and it works amazingly well, and it's quite cheap.
Yeah, it's odd to me how, as at least watching it here in America, as more government intervention and more regulation has entered the medical industry, prices have just skyrocketed, and it's gotten more and more difficult to get the healthcare you need. And just watching people think that more regulation and more government control is what's going to solve the problem that was started by government regulation and government control, it kind of seems like they have this mentality that the fire is too hot, so what we need to do is throw gasoline on it. And I just don't understand... I don't get how people make a rational connection with that mentality, but public schools, man.
That's exactly right. They, because of the indoctrination camps, 12 years of public indoctrination, I believe it was Vladimir Lenin who said that if you gave me your child for 4 years, the seed I plant will never be uprooted. In the U.S., they have 12 years now, and then they'll even go for another 4 years and pay a ton of money and go into lifelong debt for another 4 years of mostly indoctrination. So that's the reason why. So people have not been taught or even been exposed to information about how a market would work or how a free market would work. And so when they see all these horrible things, like in the U.S., I've seen all kinds of horrible things. People will go for an MRI and they'll say, well, how much is it? And the doctor will say, well, you'll get the bill afterwards. And then they get the bill afterwards and it'll be $25,000 for a 30-minute MRI. And then they're on the hook for that. So it's been just an incredibly fascist. It's so much regulation, so much government involvement in the U.S. medical system that it's atrocious, and it became so expensive. And I think they did that on purpose so that they could bring in Obamacare and say to people, well, this will fix everything. And of course, everyone's seeing now exactly how well that goes. But that's the reason why, is because people have never been exposed. It's funny because America is the land of the free and no one's heard about anything to do with freedom ever. Not no one, but most people, your great majority of people in the U.S. Have no clue what freedom even is. They actually think what the U.S. is freedom, when it is one of the least free places on earth at this moment in time.
Now, you mentioned earlier in the interview that you've been all over the world, that you went on a sailing expedition and hit multiple different areas of the world. What in your opinion, these ideas that we're talking about, I mean, they're kind of growing here in America, and I've actually even seen an emergence of a Libertarian Party in Canada, and I know some people from the UK, and I know that we have listeners of this show all over the world. We have listeners in New Zealand, in Europe, all over Asia. But as far as you mentioned that America's the least or one of the least free countries in the world, these ideas that we're talking about, are they starting to catch on in other areas of the world like we're seeing on this continent?
Absolutely. It's happening all over the world. I just got done interviewing a person from Ghana. in Africa who's got a libertarian anarcho-capitalist group movement going there. I just saw one in Nigeria with literally hundreds of students who are all anarcho-capitalists, all in a room talking about Murray Rothbard. This is happening worldwide. You brought up the Canadian Libertarian Party. The leader of that party is Tim Mohn. He's an anarchist. He was on Anarchast. He's coming down here to Acapulco for an Acapulco to be one of our speakers. So yeah, this is going all over the place, and people like Glenn Beck even are starting to wake up to the fact that this is a massive movement and it's not going to stop. This is going to turn into a landslide. We're starting to see all kinds of, I think a number of, in the last election in the U.S., a number of the congressmen and senators who were running were libertarians or anarchists who were running usually under the Republican Party just because they wouldn't get elected if they were independent. But these people are infiltrating all over the place right now. It's sort of like back in the early 1900s when communism started to catch hold. And the idea of communism was really popular back then. Well, actually it wasn't. But then it started to become really popular during the 20s and 30s. And I see the exact same thing for anarchism right now. It's exactly the same thing. 10 years ago, it was about 20 of us in a room. And we were, you know, it was a dark room in the back. And we were talking with hushed voices because we didn't, if people heard us, they'd think we were crazy or they'd want to put us in jail. And now the things we're talking about are becoming almost mainstream topics. The word libertarian wasn't even known, even by myself, 15 years ago. And today, almost everybody has heard that word and actually understands to some extent what it means. And the next word that's going to really come out is anarchism or voluntarism or whatever word we want to use, but essentially no government whatsoever. And so this is going to be an incredibly exciting time in the next decade. I think we're going to see, and because of the internet, this is the thing. In the old days, you'd have to pass around books and you go to coffee shops and try to meet somebody. Now you just turn on the internet and you can get access to all this information. So once people find out about it, they very quickly can find out everything they need and they can very quickly spread that information as well. So we could see a completely new world in the next decade. And of course, the governments realize that, and that's why they're really trying to do anything they can to censor or shut down the internet right now. They've been trying that for years. I don't think they'll be able to, though. I think the cat's out of the bag. There's too many hackers around the world who are way better than any government hackers that can get around any sort of walls or firewalls as we see in China and places like that. So yeah, this is going to be exciting times. It's going to be incredibly interesting. It's also going to be incredibly dangerous in some ways because a lot of people don't know this stuff. And when this all happens and all their governments collapse and the central banks collapse and their currencies collapse, they're going to be in shock. And I don't really want to be around too many of those kind of people when that happens because they're going to be angry and violent for a period of time. And so that's why I don't even go to the U.S. anymore because I think that's going to be ground zero. There's so many zombies there. I think that's what a lot of these zombie movies are all about is there's so many people who just are not awake. They have no ability to wake up. They're just too dumbed down. They've drank their fluoride their whole life. They're on all kinds of pharmaceuticals. And I think they're going to really, well, you can just see it. If there was one time where food stamps stopped working in one town for, I think, 6 hours, and it was near pandemonium. So you can kind of see that what will happen when those people who aren't awake start to wake up to what's going on. It's going to be interesting.
Yeah, and we've definitely created... I actually grew up on welfare and food stamps, and I would never, ever, ever go back to it. I would do everything in my power to avoid having to go back to that type of lifestyle. But I watched a lot of the people that I grew up with just go into the exact same type of lifestyle that their parents went into. And it's sad, but it's definitely a major, it's like a system of dependency. And I do have the concern that if all else fails, the government will definitely try and turn the poor against the working class as a way to keep themselves legitimized. But I don't know, man. With how bad the government has been attacking the poverty class lately, especially through police and through the court systems, I don't know if they, even though the people that are on welfare rolls, even though they're dependent on the government for their livelihood, I don't know if they would actually defend the government with how bad the government has been abusing them lately.
Yeah, it's going to be a real war for people's minds over the next few years, and that's why Alex Jones has things like InfoWars. It really is. It's a matter of us trying to get this information out as fast as possible to as many people as possible before the government does, because the government's going to try to say that it's all problems caused by capitalism and greedy capitalists and China, and we need war and all this kind of things. So it's a real race to get this information out there and to let people know what the real root causes of their problems are, and it almost always invariably is government.
Yeah, and what's funny about it is these ideas like, I want to say it was Mises. He had, when he was writing a lot of these foundational ideas that we've all kind of worked off of, he was in a very dangerous situation, and his whole library was actually confiscated by the particular government at the time that he was under. And it was ordered, all of his writings were ordered to be destroyed because they were such a threat to the socialist mentality. And one person that was ordered to destroy him found value in him and decided to hold him aside and said, I'm not going to destroy these. I'm going to secretly keep them. And because of that one person, all of these ideas were able to later be disseminated to the rest of us and built upon. And I don't know, man, like I see a lot of things that they're trying to do. I see this whole North Korea thing that's going on right now, and they're talking about how they want to use that as an excuse to censor the internet as well with the Sony North Korea gate thing. But I don't know. I honestly think that the cat's out of the bag, and anything that they do from now on is going to be futile. I think that we've already won. We just have to stay persistent. Their system, you've mentioned this a couple times already, their system is going to crash. It's going to come crumbling down. We've just got to be there to show people a voluntary solution that is better. And that's the basic premise of it, is that what we're advocating is better. Peaceful communication, peaceful voluntary interactions is better than coercive government interactions. We'll be right back on the other side of the break. This is Live Free FM. I'm your host, Nathan Fraser. We're joined today by Jeff Berwick. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. All right, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, sentient creations of all shapes, colors, and sizes, welcome back to the show. This is the second segment of the Live Free FM podcast, tentatively titled Freedom Media. I'm your host, Nathan Fraser, and today we're being joined by Jeff Berwick from the Dollar Vigilante and from Anarchast. And later we're going to talk about his newest project, which is Anarchapoco. But Jeff, you're actually located I almost totally messed up and called it Anarchapoco. You're actually located in Anarchapoco, and that's in Mexico, and that's kind of a big jump away from where you originated in Canada. But what were the motivating factors for you to relocate down there?
Well, it all started when I tried to sail the world on my sailboat. I started in Canada and I made it all the way down to El Salvador before I sunk it. And then I actually just bought a backpack and I went around the world to about at least 80 different countries on that particular trip over about 5 years. And I was just in a process of discovery, trying to figure out what's going on in the world, because I knew what I was seeing on the mainstream media wasn't the entire story, much less even close to the true story about what's going on in the world. But during that trip, I spent a lot of time in Mexico. I wasn't expecting to, because I had been to Mexico before. I liked it, of course, but I wasn't expecting to spend so much time. I actually spent almost a year just going down the west coast of Mexico through Cabo, then across the Sea of Cortez to Mazatlan, then down to Puerto Vallarta and Barra de Navidad, Ixtapa, and then Acapulco. And actually, I didn't know much about Acapulco. And so when I came in, I actually came in at night into this bay, and it's actually the most beautiful bay I've ever seen in my life. I think the only thing that comes close on Earth as far as a city goes is Rio de Janeiro. And so I came in on my boat, and I didn't know what to expect. I knew I'd heard the word. I knew when I was young in the 70s, I'd hear on Price is Right, you want a trip to Acapulco, and they'd be all excited. But I just assumed it was sort of like a tourist town or something like that. But it actually is an incredibly fascinating city. It's It's about 500 years old. The first global free trade world trade came out of Acapulco. They used to have Spanish galleons 400 to 500 years ago that would go twice a year from here to Manila, Philippines, and back. And so it's got this amazing culture. It's a very old city. It's not as touristy as I thought it was. It definitely doesn't have many American or Western tourists because they've all been sort of sent to Cabo San Lucas and Cancun now. And so this is more of a Mexican vacation spot and an actual real city on its own. And so what happened was I was going to spend about 2 or 3 days here. That was my plan. And I ended up staying about 6 weeks because I loved it so much. And then, I carried on and I went for years and years around the world. And at that point, I was living in Bangkok, Thailand, and I decided that I was getting tired and I really wanted to just have a place where I could stay for a while and that I really loved. And so I thought of all the 80 countries I'd gone to, thought of every city, and I thought, what's the one place that I loved besides Thailand, because I love Thailand as well. But at that time, I had a really crazy Thai girlfriend, which is not totally uncommon to happen. And I decided I had to get out of Thailand because it was just too much. And I thought, where was my other favorite place other than Thailand? And it was Mexico. And I thought, where was my favorite place in Mexico? And that was an easy choice for me. It was Acapulco. There's something about the vibe here. It's very free. People don't like government. This is down in the southwest. So we call this the deep south of Mexico. Even the federal government rarely comes here. They're too scared to come here because people hate them. People don't like government whatsoever. Very free lifestyle. A natural, almost anarchist sort of way of life here. And so it naturally drew me to it. And I've been living here now off and on, but mostly on, for about 6 years. And like I mentioned before, I'm going to start a conference coming up in February 27th to March 1st called Anarchapoco. And anarchists from around the world are coming, including many big Bitcoin names like Roger Ver, the Bitcoin Jesus, Cody Wilson, who started the 3D printed gun and who also does Dark Wallet. So many people, like I mentioned, Tim Moen, the Libertarian Party of Canada leader, who's an anarchist, is coming down. We're going to have people from around the world coming here. And so, yeah, that's how I ended up in Acapulco.
And you mentioned earlier, the socialized or socialist police organization, which is kind of funny because here in America, at least, the people that are most adamantly against socialism are also typically the people that are most feverishly supporting the police state, which I never really understood. They're like, redistribution is horrible. Government control of things is horrible. Government socialized funding of things is horrible, but we can't get rid of the police and military. And in Acapulco, there's actually been recently in the headlines, there's been a story about the police going on strike there and the people not doing what most people would think, which is beg for the police to come back.
Yeah, no, that's exactly right. It was around August of this year, and I had noticed that there was just a general mood in the city that seemed a little happier than usual, which is hard to tell because it's a very happy sort of a mood always, because mostly because of the weather. It's just every single day is 85 degrees and sunny every day of the year, and very tropical and just a very nice, relaxed lifestyle. But I noticed there was like even more happy than general. And I also noticed that the traffic was quite a bit better than it had been in quite a while, which was unusual because August is a big tourist month for Mexicans. When the Mexican people, mostly from Mexico City, their kids are out of school, a lot of them come here in the summer. And so I asked a friend of mine who's lived here for about 13 years, I said, have you noticed there's something just the traffic's better? Everything just seems kind of nicer, even nicer than normal. And he said, yeah, you know what it is? And I said, no. And he said, the police went on strike. He said, the municipal police went on strike and the transit police. The transit police are like the traffic cops, which usually don't do too much really, but they just kind of annoy and irritate some people from time to time, and that's about it. But they had gone on strike and no one had really noticed for a few weeks, and then it got into the media that they had gone on strike and they wanted more money. And then the talk around town was, well, it's way better without them. Why would we even want them? And so they still, to this day, I don't believe they've come back. The transit police I haven't seen. The municipal police, I believe ended up getting fired. There is one sort of bad side to this, though. It appears that the Mexican federal government is going to send in police because we need it so bad here in Acapulco. So they're going to try to federalize the police force here, which is what they're trying to do in the U.S. That's what a lot of this Ferguson stuff is all about, is trying to get rid of localized police and bring in the federal government as the police. And so that is a downside. But I think the people in Acapulco here probably won't put up with it very much. They'll probably find a way to get rid of it or do something. But yeah, it just goes to show the mentality down here. For example, if you ever have a problem, ever, the last people you would ever call is the police. If someone had done something to you or your family, for example, raped somebody or killed somebody, God forbid, or really beat someone up or something along those lines, or stole something big from somebody, the way you deal with it down here is you call all your friends and family and you find the person and you figure it out and get it back or met out your own form of justice, whatever that might be. And it actually works phenomenally well. It's excellent. And it's very rare that you really see much real crime down here. The only sort of real crime that you do see isn't really crime per se. It's usually narco gangs who usually don't operate right here in Acapulco. They all know that this is a tourist place and that they can't really do anything here. But on the outskirts of Acapulco, there is sometimes some gangs will fight it out over territory and things like that. And they'll just work out their own ways of who wins and who loses. And it usually ends up with some people killed, usually people who are just involved in this industry. So it's really not a big deal. It's just sort of how they sort of deal with things down here. There is no government, there's no laws, there's no police. And so that's the way things are done. And I much prefer it that way.
And those examples that you gave of the narcotics gangs, those really only exist because of American drug policy in the first place. So it's kind of like one of those, well, we need government to solve this problem that was created by a government solving a problem in the first place.
That's exactly right. The U.S. war on drugs has been the biggest problem to Mexico for the last decade. They've been sending down so much money, so many guns. Eric Holder sent down a ton of guns with the Fast and Furious, which actually I thank him for, because it was hard to get some really good automatic weapons down here. And he sent down a lot of them. So they're all over the place now, which is great. Makes the whole place a lot safer. And so they really appreciate that. But yeah, it's all caused all these narco problems that you hear about in Mexico. It's all caused because drugs are still illegal to transport or sell. It's actually not very well known by most people, but actually all drugs, everything is legal to own for personal possession. So you could own whatever you want, if you marijuana or whatever it is, but you're not allowed to sell or to transport large quantities of it. And that's where the real problems come in, because of course the U.S. is the biggest user of all of these substances, and a lot of these substances come from Colombia and even Mexico. And so they have to transport through here. And because it's illegal, people have to just do these things all underground. Whereas if it was all completely legalized, which it will soon be, in my opinion, you're seeing the U.S. legalizing marijuana. I think that's just the first step. Canada's already legalized marijuana. Colombia, I believe, this week legalized marijuana. There's so many countries are doing it now. And that's just the first step. The war on drugs is over. It was one of the worst, most heinous crimes against humanity of the last century. And that was a really bad century, too, including central banking. The Federal Reserve was founded in 1913. But it's going away. People are waking up to that, too. They're saying, why are we putting millions of people in cages, into prison and rape work camps? Because they had a flower in their pocket. And why are we having all these cops going door to door and busting in people's doors looking for flowers and plants? This is completely patently insane, and it's all going to go away. And that's, again, due to an awakening, thanks to the internet. Because before that, all people knew was Nancy Reagan was on TV and she'd fry an egg and she'd go, this is your egg on drugs. And people went, oh, I guess we have to just do whatever we have to stop that. But it's all going away now. People are waking up. So I think that all drugs will be legal in Mexico. And in fact, I'm actually working on that quite directly. And I think that'll all be legalized in the next year or two. And when that happens, Mexico is going to be near paradise on earth, the way it used to be. It used to be near paradise on earth. And it will return to that once this is a horrible contraption of the U.S.-led war on drugs is finally over.
And it sounds like, so this is one of the things that's, I've been actually contemplating moving to Mexico lately. I have a cousin that lives in Mexico, and he lives right on the border of California. And he said that after the drug war in California, after California has not completely legalized marijuana, but it's become such a minor offense that there's no incentive to flood California with Mexican drugs or Mexican marijuana anymore. And he said that the gang violence in his town, which was right on the border, has pretty much decreased to almost nothing now that there's no incentive for the gangs to be there. It seems like Mexico is becoming a more and more viable solution for people that want to be free. And I think that's kind of what you're trying to promote with the whole Anarcho-Poco thing. Is that part of your motivating factor?
Yeah, I don't really have a true motivation. I just noticed that it is much freer here. This is definitely by far the most free country in North America, right beside the land of the free of all places. Mexico is doing very well. Not many people know this. The Mexican stock market is up about 500% in the last decade. That's compared to the U.S., which is about flat over the last decade. And every week I read about major manufacturers moving to Mexico. In fact, a lot of the ones that moved to China, because China used to be so cheap with the labor, are moving to Mexico now because China has risen so much. Their economy has been booming so much that labor has gone up 2-3 times in the last 5 years. And so there's a lot of people are moving a lot of their production. A lot of auto manufacturers are all moving here. The economy is doing very well. And so, yes, if they can just get rid of this war on drugs, which is going to happen, and as you pointed out, that's the main reason why Mexico needs to legalize and decriminalize all drugs right now, or they're going to lose a lot of business, because once the U.S. legalizes everything, and it will, then there will be no incentive to need much stuff from Mexico. So I've been talking to a lot of the government people and a lot of the cartel people. They're all the same people, and said, you know, if you guys don't legalize this stuff, like in the next year or two, you guys are going to be out of business. And if you legalize it now and you get ahead of the pack and you start to take in a lot of the money from the legal market, then you can be a player in the world legalized and decriminalized drug market. But until that point, you guys are toast. So it's going to be fascinating and interesting to see what happens. The big reason they don't want to give it up is because everyone here, not everyone, but the cartels and the government, which are the same, as I pointed out, make so much money from this, the way the market is today, that they don't want to give it up. But I'm trying to explain to them that whether or not they want to give it up or not, it's over. And if they don't get ahead of the curve and legalize and decriminalize everything, then they're going to lose out. So it's an incredibly fascinating time. There's tons of opportunities. We just saw the other day, Cuba, the U.S. Lightened its restrictions on Cuba. That's going to change that island dramatically. There's so much stuff going on. For entrepreneurs, there's so much opportunity, and Mexico's one of the places where there's a ton of opportunity.
Yeah, it's definitely an exciting time to be alive. It's kind of scary in certain aspects, but I don't know, man. I still remain hopeful for humanity because I have met a lot of brilliant and wonderful human beings, and it seems like the majority of the really horrible human beings that I've met or that I am aware of, they tend to gravitate towards this one section of society called government. And the rest of us just kind of want to be left alone and want to leave each other alone. And the small section of society known as government is losing favor in a lot of people's eyes. And I don't know, I mentioned earlier, I think that the system is going to crumble. It's inevitable, it seems like, and we just got to show a viable alternative. One of the things that I wanted to touch on before we're out of here is you mentioned people handling their problems without the government down there. And I've seen stories, a lot of stories actually, more and more frequently, where the governments of particular towns are so corrupt, so overran by cartel members, so in bed with the local cartels that the people lose all faith in the police, the people lose all faith in the government. And instead of just throwing their hands up in disgust and saying, there's no solution to this problem if government's not going to solve it, I keep reading these stories of people taking the law into their own hands and I read a story just recently about a town full of mothers who were just sick and tired of their children falling victim to the cartels, and they just all took all their guns and basically rounded up the cartel members and said, look, you guys aren't operating here anymore, and if you don't go peacefully, you're going to go violently. And it seems like the mentality down there, at least from a lot of the stories that I read, is they don't wait for the government to solve the problems. If there's a problem, they say, hey, we should get up and solve this ourselves. And you mentioned that the entrepreneurial spirit is ripe there. And that's something that very much so seems to permeate in a lot of the entrepreneurs that I know, is that their solution isn't, let's try and figure out how government can solve their problem. Their solution is, well, government's not going to solve this problem. Let's go ahead and just figure out how to solve this ourselves. So do you think that there might be an overlap between the basic mentality of not trusting government to solve the problems that is attracting some sorts of entrepreneurs to that area?
I'm not sure about that, but definitely Mexico, a lot of Mexico. Mexico is a very large country. A lot of people forget that, and a lot of people assume that if someone's Mexican, then they're just this sort of person. Mexico is almost as big as the U.S. in terms of land size. It's massive, and there's people, different kinds of people in every part of Mexico. Down here in the south, however, they've got a real, sort of similar to the U.S., they've got a real anti-government, very freedom-minded mindset. Not everybody, but a lot of people. And yeah, you can see that. The thing you brought up, I believe that happened in this state. Acapulco's in a state called Guerrero. Guerrero means warrior. And many of the people here are actually Aztecs. And so they still have that very Aztec sort of mentality. And yeah, they don't put up with much government. And but on the other side, you brought up entrepreneurialism. At the same time, many Mexicans still aren't very good at business, at entrepreneurialism. They don't really understand. They haven't really, not all, but most, have no idea how to really run a business well. There's so many businesses down here that don't even have a website. I'm constantly just seeing things that they should be doing that they aren't doing. For example, there'd be so many places that, for example, there'd be this one lady who has a really amazing chocolate thing that she sells, and she'll have a stand on the corner, and she's there every day for years and years, but there's no sign or anything, and there's no name of it or anything. So if you just say, oh, you know who makes the best chocolates? And someone would say, no, who? And you'd be like, well, I don't know. They don't really have a name or anything. It's that lady on the corner. She has no website. She has no sign. She has no name. So a lot of stuff like that. So that's why there's real opportunities for entrepreneurs down here, because you can kind of, a lot of us from a place like the US or even socialist Canada, we kind of understand how business should be done for the most part. That's something that we've been lucky, that we've been around a lot of really well run businesses for most of our lives. And so we know how things should and could be run very well. And they don't know those sort of things a lot in most of Latin America. So there's a ton of opportunity for people who want to. If anyone's entrepreneurial minded and they go to a place like Mexico or anywhere in Latin America, really, they probably won't go through a day without seeing 8 really good business ideas. So yeah, it's a ton of opportunity. There's not much regulation. For example, here in Acapulco, if you want to start a bar, you just rent a place and buy some tequila and some beer and you have a bar. That's it. There's no regulation. There's no approvals. There's no alcohol serving permits. There's no closing time. You just close when everyone's left. So it's
but what about the children?
Well, they go to the bars too. That's the really cool thing. And you know what? Like, you'll see kids at bars, like 14 years old, 13 years old, and they never, ever are very drunk at all. They usually have just a sip of a beer or whatever. They usually don't like it very much, but they like the dancing and all that kind of stuff. It's because they're not allowed to do those things. The people here are very relaxed, whereas in the U.S., in some places, you can't even have a beer legally until you're 21. So a lot of people are just sitting there waiting, and then they turn 21, and they just start doing shots until they throw up. Whereas a lot of people who just don't have all these regulations, like a lot of people in Mexico, Europe's very much like this. People will be having wine at home with their kids. The kids might be 11 years old and have a sip of wine when they have dinner. It's not a big deal. And because of that, they don't get all crazy and want to get all drunk. So yeah, it's just a different lifestyle. And because of all the much less regulation, much less government involvement in everyone's day-to-day life, everyone's happier. People don't feel the need to get really drunk. That's another reason reason why people in the U.S., they're just constantly being surveilled. They have to stop at a stop sign, and they have to watch out for cops all day. Then they go to their work, and there's all these regulations and rules, and the taxes get taken off their check. And then they barely have any money to survive. And so then the weekend comes, and they go out, and they only have a couple hours because the bars close at 1:30 when the government says they're supposed to close. So people just start downing shots until they pass out. It's just a crazy, horrible lifestyle.
Yeah, absolutely. So we're about out of time. I did want to, I like to end the show on an up note. And I know that the world can be a giant storm sometimes, but I like to take a minute and reflect on the silver lining, some of the things that make our guests hopeful about the future. What is it that's going on right now that you're most hopeful about in the pro-liberty movement?
Well, as we mentioned before, I think the big thing is just how much it's spreading now. This is completely spreading. You're starting to see in the U.S. people like the Republican Party or the GOP, they're starting to recognize that most of the people that are really, if they're going to have any chance to exist anymore, are mostly all libertarians. So very quickly, that entire party could turn almost completely libertarian. And so we're seeing that all over the world. People are waking up. People are finding new ways to live outside of these systems. Things like Bitcoin are very exciting. That separates us from the central banking cartels, and it's a true, honest money. It's a good money. There's no one who controls it. There's no Janet Yellen in a boardroom deciding what it's worth and how much money she's going to print this week. So there's nothing but great, exciting things to be optimistic about. But at the same time, as we pointed out, as these other systems collapse, it could be a little hairy for a few years.
Yeah, absolutely. Let people know where they can go to find out more about Jeff Berwick.
Sure. I'm all over the interweb. You can just Google it. But dollarvigilante.com is where I talk a lot about the coming collapse of the U.S. dollar. If you're interested in things like liberty, just go to Anarchast on YouTube. You'll find us there. We interview anarchists almost every week or even more than that lately. And then if you're really, really interested in seeing true what much more freedom looks like and you're interested in freedom, come on down to Anarchapoco in Acapulco, February 27th to March 1st. That's just ANARCHAPULCO.com. I know it's hard to spell. I didn't think about that when I made up the name, but there's going to be a lot of great people down here.
No, I think it's awesome. And what are some of the things that we've got about a minute left, so I'll let you cram this in. What are some of the things that you've got planned for that? I've heard some of the things, but for the listeners that are unaware, how have you got what's your envisionment for that?
Well, so many anarchists are doing so many amazing things, so many anarcho-capitalists especially, that I named the conference Rethink, Reinvent All the Things, because people are rethinking everything that we've done over the last few hundred years. And for example, we have an unschooling one-day workshop with Dana Martin, who's an expert in unschooling. So that's where you don't even send your kids to school at all. You don't even homeschool, and it works phenomenally well. So we're going to have all sorts of things like that. We're going to have ExoBase, which is an entrepreneurship work camp, which is a two-day camp. These are all before the conference and the week before the conference. And we're also going to have Luke Radowski of We Are Change and Dan Dix of Press for Truth. That'll be doing a one-day Change Media University, teaching people how to create media in this new world.
Awesome. It sounds exciting. I hope that I can make it out. If you are listening right now and you've got the ability to make it out there, I would definitely recommend it. Thank you very much for coming on. I really appreciate your time. I know that your time is valuable. My listeners' time is valuable, and I think that you exchanged a lot of value today. So thank you very much, Jeff Berwick, Dollar Vigilante, Anarchast, Anarchapoco, all over the place. It's been a pleasure. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been another exciting episode of Live Free FM. Go and check out livefreefm.com. Tons of archives, tons of great interviews with great guests like Jeff. And it will be definitely worth your time. Until next week, have faith in each other, not in authority. This is Live Free FM. I'm out of here. Peace.